Anybody that's 50 and over, just raise your hand. I'm going to sing to you a song that my mother, when I first started playing the piano, she called me to the dean. And she said, sit here and play this. And the song I heard my mother sing, just the verse of it, Mama said, out of the Lord, we'll make a way. Yes, he, I didn't understand that until I started asking. Ooh, out of the Lord, we'll make a way. Is that all right? Yes, he will. You know that new stuff is fine, but I like songs like this.
Well, she did. She said, Daddy just transitioned.
my socks and I went outside and I sat in the rocking chair, and the only thing that I could say was, I need the old, I need the, I wish I had a church now.
Sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. The grass withereth, the flower thereof fadeth away, but the word of our Lord will stand forever. You may be seated. I want to talk this morning. I want to talk about steps for staying in the race. If you're going to be a good soldier, you are going to have to learn how to stay in the race.
Yeah.
See, you're not going to talk to me. Reach over and touch your neighbor and say, neighbor,
yeah,
take your amen out of your pockets. In order to be, Lord have mercy, in order to be a good usher or a good soldier or a good Christian, there are some characteristics that you must possess. If you talk to me, I'll get through. And since it's being ushered anniversary, do you mind if I talk to the ushers for about 2 minutes? Do you mind if I just share something with them? Well, you got to understand, if you are going to be a good usher, there are just a few characteristics that I want to point out that you must have. First of all, in order to be a good usher, you must have the characteristic that will produce something that's called proclivity. In other words, proclivity is a tendency to do something regularly. In other words, there ought to be something on the inside of you that makes you want to usher on a regular basis. I ain't got no help, but I'm a preacher now. There ought to be something on the inside of you as a Christian to make you come to church on a regular basis. There ought to be something, y'all ain't gonna talk to me, brother. There ought to be something on the inside of you to make you praise God on a regular basis. Because David said, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continuously. You're not talking to me. Your characteristic ought to produce proclivity. But not only that, ushers, you need to have the characteristic that also produces propensity. Let's see. Propensity is simply a tendency to behave in a particular way.
All right.
Yes, sir. All right. Yes, sir.
Okay, let me talk to myself. In other words, when you come to the house of the Lord to stand at the door, you ought to behave in a particular way. We don't want to see you frown. You may have had a bad night, but when I come into the house of the Lord, I don't want to see you with a frown on your face like you mad at the world. And if I say something, I don't know whether to speak to you or run. Come on, you're not talking to me. But there ought to be something on the inside of you to make you smile every once in a while. There ought to be something on the inside of you that will influence you to operate in excellence. You need to produce, am I doing pretty right,
sir? Yes, sir.
You need to produce some propensity. But that's let me get to the text because I'm tired already. But that one major characteristic that every true believer ought to possess.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
And you ought to have the characteristic of love.
All right.
You gonna talk to me?
Yeah.
Jesus said, "You will know my disciples
not
by how well they preach,
right. Not
by how well they sing. Y'all ain't talking.
Right.
Not by how well you shout on a Sunday morning or how you dress." He said, "You want to know my disciple by the love that they have." You're not talking. He said, "Because love and kindness have I drawn thee." And my grandmother used to have a little saying. She said, "You could draw a whole lot of flies with sugar than you can venom." And some of us would be a little sourpuss attitude. Come on, talk to me. Some of us just have some nasty and ugly ways. Come on. And folk hate to come to church because they know how you act. Come on. You cussing and fussing on the job and you want to invite me to. Come on, y'all ain't talking to me. You act ugly to me on the job, and when I come to the church, I got to figure out who you is acting. We don't exemplify the love that God has given us. Well, the Bible said, "For God so loved the world that he gave." I wish I had some Bible readers in here. He gave it only. And God, y'all want to talk to me. Let me get some text. Listen. Nowhere in the Bible that God promised us that this Christian life was going to be easy.
Come on now.
He never promised me that pastoring was going to be easy.
Yeah.
I've been here for going on 4 years. Mm-hmm. Just had the third year anniversary.
Amen.
And in the first 3 years, there are 365 days of the year.
Yeah.
I guarantee you 350 of them I cry. But I'm still here. He never promised that it was going to be easy, but he did say, Lord, I am with y'all ain't talking. Always even until the end. He promised that he was going to be with me. Yes, difficulties are going to come. Even when you're ushering, there are going to be some difficult times. There are going to be some difficult days. There are going to be some times when folk come in where, you know, they're not so polite. And you know that person has been talking about you because Sally was the one called and told you. And Sally is the same one that's texting you while you're in church. Time I look at a girl, look just. Don't look now, but she's staying you now. Now we're talking. And that's the same person that you're going to have to walk up and offer a fan to. Y'all not going to talk to me. A difficult time is going to come, but I want to encourage you not to drop out of this race. Because the race is not given to the swift, neither the battle to the strong. It's a him that endured until the end. I wish I had some help in this room. Jesus said on one occasion, he that put his hand to the plow, looking bad is not fit for the kingdom. Come on, look at your neighbor and say, you better check yourself before you wreck yourself. The author of Hebrews is comparing the Christian life to a race. He wasn't talking about a 100-yard dash, but he was talking about a marathon. And even though, Lord have mercy, even though I'm not in shape to run a marathon, I was a little bit smaller than this before I came. Though I'm not in shape to run a marathon, but I can be spiritually in shape to run this race. You got to understand, in order to run this race, in order to stay in this race, there are some rules that goes with the race. Oh, shucks, let me preach you. Well, one of the rules is, if you're going to enter into the race, you got to enter in it to win it. There's no need of you getting into a race. You know, just talking about, I'm just going to run today. You are not wasting your time just running. But at the end of the book suggests to me that I have a crowd that's waiting for me if I finish the race. One of the rules, of the race is to enter into it and win it. But another rule of the race is you have to have patience in running this race. Preach Michael Jackson. You got to have some patience in this race because there are some folk, Miss Shaw, who will make you cuss on a Sunday. Don't look at me like you don't cuss. Don't look into me. Come on now. Don't do it, even if you slip, but no, you don't do that to me. Come on. You know, even Steve Harvey said, Sister Odell, cuz. Y'all ain't gonna talk to me. But there are some, So you have to have patience with baby kids.
Come on now.
You have to have patience with that mother who don't want you to cast tide and look bored for tearing up the church hymn books. You got to have patience. patience with that mother who don't understand that this book that's called the Bible in the back of the pew is not for your son or your daughter to write in. Y'all not gonna talk to me. And you got to have patience, because at time you touch one another, you got to have a church meeting.
You know what I'm saying?
You know what I'm saying? She had to talk to me like I'm.
You know what I'm saying?
She don't know who was. She better be glad I ain't like I used to be. Understand, they were just ordinary people. They received their reward. And I want to encourage you, ushers, as you go through this time, this next year, come up, there are times you want to give up. There are times that you want to throw in the towel. But I just want to encourage you by telling you to stay in the race. And not only do you must you consider the saints, but secondly, you have to consider yourself. It's in verse number 2. He said, lay aside every weight and sin that so easily beset us. In other words, the biggest problem that you have is yourself. You got folk who are Christians, come to church, they save, sanctify, filled with the Holy Ghost, all that kind of stuff.
No.
You know what I'm saying? All that kind of stuff. And you want me to like you. And you don't even like yourself. Okay. I know some of y'all don't agree with that. Let me help you then, since you don't agree with it. When you get up in the morning, you don't like how your breath smells. You don't like how your hair is. That's why you comb your comb. But you want me to put up with y'all ain't talking. So there are sometimes you have to lay aside some stuff that's causing you not to praise God. You got to lay aside some things that's causing you not to be a servant in the kingdom. Everybody in the primitive church want a position. Everybody around want to be this, want to be president, want to be vice president, want to be doctor, want to be this, want to be missionary, want to be that, want to be that. Run about who won't serve. God is looking for some folk who are going to settle in the kingdom. You got to understand, if you don't have a kingdom agenda, then you're in the wrong business. I'm a preacher. You got to understand, there are some things that are not sin, but it is a weight. Bible class starts at 7 o'clock.
Yeah.
Empire comes on. Watching Empire ain't no sin. It becomes a weight because it's stopping you from doing what you're supposed to be doing. Y'all not gonna talk to me. Some of us are working 2 and 3 jobs. That it's not, you're trying to get ahead. And that's not prosperity, that's a weight. And then you know the devil thinks that your only day off is Sunday.
Talk about it.
I don't have to say no more. Yes, things become a weight, and you're going to have to lay aside everything that is causing you not to serve the master.
Right.
Are you going to talk to me?
Yes, sir.
And please don't get mad with me. Don't get mad with me when I say that. I mean, you know, I told somebody the other day, this, and they got real angry with me. Because I told them, I said, buying liquor ain't no sin. Y'all please don't get mad with me. I'm explaining to my mother that said,
good.
What she waiting for? You might have to straighten that one up for me. Brother Jack, the reason why buying Jack Daniel is not a sin is because it's for sale.
Yeah.
You ain't stealing it.
Come on.
to sin when you indulge and get drunk. Because the Bible said that wine is a mocker and strong drinks are raging, and whoever take it therein is not wise. And it's not, and watch this, here's the way. You buying it can become a stumbling block in a sinner's way. It's not legal here. We're going to buy a little bag, a little 5 cent bag. Now that's a sin. You might look on. Come on, y'all ain't gonna talk to me. Now that's where the sin comes. You know, like, oh, y'all ain't gonna talk to me last Friday. You know, down here on Virgin and Peoria, we call that a little sinny sin sin. Everything that stops you, Lord have mercy, to coming to Bible class and coming to the worship hour. I gotta close. I've been up here too long. Not only can I just preach like I feel.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Not only should you consider the saints.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And not only should you consider yourself. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, the last thing that you have to consider is you have to consider the Savior. Well,
God for that cheeseburger that reminded us that, and that we need to stay in the reason that we already have victory. The Bible tells us that we have victory in Jesus Christ. So there's no need to quit, because if you endure, you will get that crown that is waiting for you. The doors of the church are open. The Bible says that we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But the Bible also reminds us that because we sin, God sent his only begotten Son to die on the cross, to shed his blood, so that if we believe in him, that we will not perish, but we will have everlasting life. So we extend Christ to you this morning. We offer him to you. If you do not know Christ for the pardon of your sins, this will be a perfect time to give your life over to him. The doors of the church are open.